as Sandeep said, if you have a spine case, it is obviously sometimes you are worried, but sometimes you should be happy that you have a spine case, because there are more chances if you do well in a spine case you will pass rather than in any other case. And actually spine is easy if you look at it that way. If you look at it that it is a difficult case, you will definitely be more making more mistakes. So what I will be giving you in 12 minutes is just an overview of how a spine examination is done rather than completing it. As in any case, before you start a spine case examination, you should introduce yourself, explain the patient what you are going to do, gain confidence by talking some, maybe not scientific, but maybe something from his past, from his village, wherever. That gains a lot of confidence, where he then tries to give you more and more input from his illness rather than he being disinterested and you trying to take something from him. Patient should be exposed properly, and if there is a female patient, make sure a female nurse or a relative is there, obviously necessary for doing a good examination. Also, make the patient comfortable that if there is pain while doing any examination, ask him to stop you. Now in spine, you have two primary in any, as in any examination, history and examination. But spine, the thing is, there is more of symptoms than on signs. So more focus is usually on history and less on examination, because sometimes, as in the case of spinal canal stenosis, you'll have very few signs, but you'll have a lot of symptoms to dwell upon. So history is primarily very important, and history primarily tells you the evolution of the disease, the morbidity of the disease, as well as at the same time, it helps you to evaluate for red and yellow flag. Does anyone know what is red and yellow flag? Red flag, obviously, you must be knowing. What is a yellow flag?
Work habits.
Yes, so it's something psychosomatic or work related, work compensation. In our case, work compensation may not be that common in India, but yes, sometimes the patient tries to fool you by saying more and more of some symptom which actually has no relevance to the present illness. So you have to be very careful about these red as well as yellow flags. Red flags definitely, whereby you know that there is some more ominous disease present rather than what it looks to. The other thing, questions have to be chronological and precise. Because sometimes, as I told you, the patient can just take you for a ride. When you ask Mungya Etatka, the patient may try to tell you so many things about when there is tingling that you forget what the main symptom is. So if you are precise in the, okay, Mungya Etatka, okay, finish. Then you have to lead the patient rather than patient continuing on himself in trying to describe his symptoms more and more. Obviously, in history, you have to go in for all of these. But primarily, when you go for the presenting chief complaints, you have pain, swelling, weakness, deformity. And fourth thing, the fifth thing which obviously we sometimes miss is bladder and bowel, which sometimes because of social customs, patient may not tell you that there is a bladder problem or a bowel problem. So you have to definitely ask him, is there a bladder or bowel problem? You may not insist on asking him what is the exact nature of the bladder problem. Yes, he tells, yes, I have a bladder problem, I cannot evacuate properly. That's what is okay, even if you tell that. Don't try to decipher it more, that whether it is dribbling incontinence, with overflow incontinence, there is nothing that you can find out on history. Then each complaint you have to again dissect it out on the ODP, the origin, duration, progress. You have to be very sure on what the pain nature is. So if you think of pain, then whether it's unilateral, bilateral, central, upper level, lumbar level, whether there is leg pain more than back pain, how did it start? How is it evolving? The relationship between back and leg pain. Sometimes in a classical disc herniation, even the patient will say that I had back pain initially, it was very severe, and now I have leg pain and my back pain is not there. So that probably has a classical presentation that it is a disc herniation which you are dealing with. Is coughing painful? Again, sneezing, straining increases pain in disc herniations. It may also in infective etiologies. But that's one thing which you can find out, and such things, such questions help you to understand the pain much better. The most important thing is nocturnal pain. If the patient sleeps well but gets up at night because of pain, sometimes the patient may say that I have a disturbed sleep, but that does not mean he necessarily has a pain at night. So pain, nocturnal pain is pain which wakes up the patient and not insomnia. Again, you have to ask him about the previous treatment, what he has taken for each episode of pain and what he has benefited from that also. Now, ideally, I don't know whether it is permissible or not, but I think if you carry such a VASC scale, or you can just add it and ask the patient to mark on a VASC score what is your back pain and what is your leg pain. Because many a times in front of you, the patient says, I have severe pain. But when the examiner asks him, oh, my back pain is not very severe. So you may be, the patient may try to confuse you in front of the examiner. So it is best that you give him the patient and yes, his pain is 6 on 10. His pain is 7 on 10. He has marked it himself. So then there is no ambiguity about how severe is the back pain or how severe is the leg pain. So VASC score for back as well as leg pain has to be charted. And at the same time, if you can, I would prefer, I was given an opportunity in my MS exam, I would carry a pain diagram and try to mark it immediately where the pain is and tell the patient, yes, this is where your pain is, yes. Because in that case, it becomes very easy to tell the examiner as well that where the pain radiation is, back pain is more, leg pain is more, instead of trying to describe it how it is. Again, ask for history of trauma, history of constitutional symptoms, any known cancer, which obviously, again, you have to ask, comorbidities, and the treatment history has to be asked, whether he has received any investigations, how many times investigations, any conservative management, surgical management, any injections, biopsy, everything. If he has a surgery done, implants used, nowadays patients know everything. So you can tell that there was an implant put. In your history, you should be able to find out whether the pain, what the patient is talking about, is radicular or somatic referred. Sometimes the patient says, I have leg pain, but that need not be always radicular pain. So there is a difference between symptomatology of radicular and referred pain going into the leg. So in radicular pain, the pain in the leg is always more than back. It's opposite in somatic. In radicular pain, the pain is in a specific dermatome, lancinating, shooting, and it has got some tingling, numbness along with it. In case of somatic referred pain, usually there is no tingling and it extends in a non-specific myotomal or dermatomal region. It is not specific. Similar thing, you should be able to differentiate, especially in a lumbar canal stenosis. This is the only positive history which you get. So if you have a lumbar canal stenosis, your most of the discussion will go on claudication itself. So you should be very thorough on what is neurogenic and what is vascular claudication. The third thing, obviously, of claudication is venous, so varicose veins. So all these three things should be explained. You should know and have a history that neurogenic claudication is variable. So every time the distance varies. So sometimes the patient can walk 200 meters, there is no pain. Sometimes the patient can walk 2 kilometers and there is no pain. So the distance at which he gets symptoms is variable, while at vascular, there is definite fixed distance that he walks. And obviously the other things which you obviously must be knowing. So after the history has been taken, you should have a fair idea of the diagnosis. So diagnosis, it is only degenerative, infective, inflammatory, post-traumatic, tumor, or congenital or development, like scoliosis. So you have a history, you have a diagnosis, working diagnosis, it is either of these. And one needs to just establish the same by examination. So I would prefer that the history should not be a separate thing. As you start examining, you also to take history. So there should not be two separate compartments because you have a time limit. So history and examination can go sideways. At the same time, you can add on to the examination depending on what you get in history. In examination, you have two ways of doing it. Is what you follow normally is inspection, palpation, movements, motor, and special test. But what I would prefer is doing it how you would normally do it in an outpatient practice. So you would first see the patient walking, standing, sitting, then you ask the patient to lie supine, and then you ask the patient to lie prone, and do all the tests in that position, whatever are there. So instead of repeatedly asking, no, so I have to do a straight leg raising now, so I have to do this thing. So you do all these, you have to picture in mind. So when the patient stands itself, you do a few tests, when he sits, when he lying down. So I would do an examination in that form rather than fragmenting it into all these. So in standing, obviously you ask the patient to walk in front of you. You see how he is walking, there is a gait analysis, whether he can walk or not because of weakness sometimes. So he is walking with an aid, without aid. Inspection, movements in standing position, the flexibility assessment using the modified Schober's test, and motor conduction of L5 and S1 group. And as I will tell you. So as you talk with the patient, observe the standing, walking and changing positions as he lies down. Look for surgical scars, neurocutaneous markers. Sometimes if there is a listasis, that's again the only sign which will tell you that there is an obvious step which is palpable only when the patient is standing. When the patient is lying down, sometimes the step may not be palpable. So when the patient is standing, you should take care that you palpate the spinous processes and see for obvious step for a kyphotic deformity or a scoliotic deformity. Sometimes you get a sciatic list, which is obvious, again, radiating pain, but that such positive findings should have a separate column on your writing sheet so that whenever you present your final diagnosis, you can say, on because of these positive findings, my diagnosis is this. So, motor testing for L5 and S1 root can be tested easily by asking the patient to walk on heels and walk on toes. So walking on heels tests the L5 and L4 root. Walking on your toes tells you the S1 root. All these movements, obviously, should be tested. You may not write the exact angle, but you can say that this is restricted, this is painful, this is not possible. One thing in the scoliosis patient, which obviously Rajesh is going to talk in detail, but you have to do a forward bending of the Adam's crease in a scoliosis patient to tell that it is a fixed and structural scoliosis and not a correctable scoliosis. Again, describing adolescent scoliosis, you have in inspection, you should describe it in the proper words so that the examiner knows that what you have looked at, the shoulder symmetry, the skin folds, and the arm distance, the flank folds, everything has to be described in a crisp sentence which you can find out. Again, I don't know whether it will be available, but sometimes you may be asked about what is ATR, the angle of trunk rotation. So a scoliometer may be kept, may not be kept. You can say that scoliometer is not for your clinical practice, it is for just school. Sometimes if you do a school camp, scoliometer is there as a screening tool, it is not to be used in clinical practice as such. So any scoliometer angle more than 5 has supposed to be referred to a higher center. The scoliometer may not be kept in your examinations, but you should know when to use it. So it is used as a screening tool in camps. Then you ask the patient to sit. So in sitting, what all you can do? First of all, if there is a cervical spine problem, then you should also do the cervical spine movements in a sitting position. Again, inspection, palpation for tenderness can be done. Again, if you are not comfortable, you are not confident about, or the patient is not cooperating in the standing position, the dorsal spine, the cervical spine, easily palpable in the sitting position. Neck movements have to be done. And one other thing is sitting SLR. So you normally, casually, talking to the patient, ask the patient to lift the leg. So if the patient moves, leans backwards, it means the patient has a positive SLR. So this is a test which you can find out, yes, you are dealing with some straight leg raising test, should be positive in the examination what you are doing. Then comes the supine position. So in supine position, you should check the hip joints, the sacroiliac joints first, because that's what you would miss. The patient can have morbidity or disease at two locations at the same time. So the third thing, obviously, you should check for dural tension signs. Then the motor testing, sensory testing, reflexes, and last, should not miss, is the dorsal pulsalis pedis and posterior tibial pulse. Sometimes a claudication patient, and you have not checked the pulse, and you strongly say, oh no, pulse is normal. And if the patient has a weak pulse, you may be in a problem. So you should always check for dorsalis pedis as a pulse and see for varicose veins. You can be, if you have checked and it is not there, the examiner will say, compliment you, yes, okay, you have examined it. Because in clinical practice also sometimes you may not undress the patient completely. So you have, but that just tells you that you know, you are aware of the causes for claudication. Then lastly is the prone, where you again do the palpation, motor and sensory examination in the prone position. The femoral stretch test is to be done in the prone position. So that's a special test to be done in the prone position. Again, you should check for perianal sensation and anal sphincter contraction, especially if you have a spinal cord tumor case where there is sacral sparing and you need to assess that, or a spinal cord injury patient. So in such, which sometimes you may not be, but you should know that in that position you should check that. Now, I'll slightly go in some details of the neurological examination. The neurological examination is especially to find out the level of spine involvement. So it may not be done to the same extent so precisely, but why you are doing it, you should know. So you are doing it to find out where the lesion is. So in neurological examination, you have the tone, vesting, sensory, motor, reflexes, the superficial and the deep. So this is a busy picture, but I liked it. Yeah, you can get it on the net also. But this is a very good way of describing how a sensory examination, a detailed sensory examination is to be done. You should know about it, but you may not do it in practice. You just do pinprick and light touch in specific dermatomes to find out if those dermatomes are involved. In sensory examination, the most important thing, if you are going to find a positive finding, then you should be very patient. So don't go hurriedly through the same. The vibration, the position, two-point discrimination, tactile movements, everything, you should know how to do it. But those are important in posterior column tract where there is subacute combined lesion. So they are mostly important in medical myelopathies rather than surgical patients. So as we described, you should know the dermatomes. So if you say that there is hyperstasia in the C5 dermatome, you should be able to point out where the C5 dermatome is. So as you say, this is C6. So C6, C7, C8, T1. So it is easy to remember, but you should check it in those dermatomes because that is what matters to you the most. Similarly, for the lower limb. In the torso again, the nipple levels is T4, the xiphoid is T7, umbilicus is T10, and the groin is T12. So by having, if you know the level of sensory involvement, then you can also find out the involvement in the corresponding motor level as well as the vertebral level on palpation. So motor examination, you have to do sequentially in upper and lower limbs, test the reflexes simultaneously. So this is a simple chart to find out how you can check the C5, C6, C7, C8, T1 as well as L12. So you should be knowing, if someone says you have tested knee extension, so what does it test? You say it is quadriceps. But quadriceps are primarily supplied by which nerve? So that is where you should think of L3 is for quadriceps. L4, check for dorsiflexion of the ankle. So that is primarily. EHL is L5. Everters are S1. Plantar flexors are also S1. And S1, S2 or the medial hamstring, and L5 and S1 are the hamstring muscles. Then this is again to tell you the same about the reflexes and the motor findings at each level. So it is, once you can find out the level of involvement, you can make a diagnosis, clinical diagnosis as far as that is concerned. So this we have already discussed about it. Now sometimes clinically you have a deformity or a tenderness, severe tenderness at a particular level in the spine. So you should know at what clinical level it matters. Though finally you are going to take an X-ray, but clinically you have to find out which level is there. So most prominent spinous process is C7. And below that you can go one by one to find out which spinous process you are dealing with. Again, highest level of iliac crest is L4, but it can vary. The correlation between vertebral and neural levels also, you should know that if a vertebral level is D1 to D6, add two levels to it to have the neural levels, because the cord ends at L1. So that is how you can find out. The superficial reflexes have to be...
2 minutes more.
So the abdominal reflexes, the plantars, and the cremasteric reflex. Mind well, while describing the plantar reflex, you have to be, sometimes it is equivocal that the patient has a withdrawal response. Then you have to make the patient slightly comfortable and check it again the next time after some time, rather than repeatedly doing the same thing again and again, where the patient will give you a withdrawal response. The other thing, you should not reach the ball of the great toe, because of that sometimes you get a plantar extensor. So you should stop it before the ball of the first toe in eliciting it. Again, you should know the differences between an UMN lesion and an LMN lesion, which you should be able to just state away immediately. Sometimes you may be asked about, though it may not be performed, but as in a viva, if you are doing well, you may be asked what is a bulbocavernosus reflex, how to do it. So it is usually it's a polysynaptic reflex where you are pressing the glans and the inner sphincter contracts. It is useful in cases of spinal shock, where if bulbocavernosus reflex has come and there is no motor or sensory recovery, it means that there is a chance of a complete spinal cord injury. So that's the only thing what it tests. Sometimes to just trick you, how will you elicit it? So you will say in a male, you will press the glans. But say, how will you elicit in a female? So most of the times this is done by pulling on the Foley's catheter. Usually most of these patients are catheterized. So if they ask you to perform in a patient, now perform a bulbocavernosus reflex on this patient. So they say, I cannot perform on this because it is not indicated in this patient. So you should be bluntly refusing it rather than start doing it in a patient. The special test will be again discussed with each pathology, but the modified Schobert test is the initial modification, I'll tell you, but you mark the level of the PSIS, mark 5 centimeters below and 10 centimeters above. The modification is initial Schobert did not mark 5 centimeters below, so it does not, I don't know what difference it makes. And then ask the patient to bend down if the distance should be more than 20 centimeters. The straight leg raising test, obviously Tushar is going to talk on it, but again it is a passive test. So it is not a test where you ask the patient to lift his leg on his own. So it is a passive test, you have to lift the leg completely by yourself. The straight leg raising test is the most sensitive, but it is not very specific. But well leg raising test, suppose if you get this positive, then it is specific for a disc herniation, but it is not sensitive. So you should know what is specificity and sensitivity of the test. Test for sacroiliac joint, there are many, but primarily you can do two, the Gainsland test and the Faber test, the flexion, abduction, external rotation. Testing, for sometimes you may be asked if it is piriformis, it is just for clinical thing, nobody will, but if you are want someone wants to just test you, so you should be knowing this, so it is called as a flare test. So it is flexion, adduction and internal rotation. So if you do this and the patient gets pain which is radiating, it can be piriformis syndrome. For the cervical spine, you have the Sperling test for neck in extension, rotation and lateral flexion and compression. If you have radiating pain, it tells that there is a probably nerve root compression. The Adson test for vascular insufficiency, again as an added special test. The Beaver sign, if you have a cord lesion and D10 where the lower abdominal muscles are working, not working, but the upper, you can ask the patient to get up and you will say the amperthesis. The Hoover test is for malingerers. You may know about it. Obviously, the patient you are seeing is not a malingerer, but if somebody asks you, you should be knowing what Hoover test is. Again, in the upper limb, if you have a cervical myelopathy, three tests are important. The Hoffman test, the inverted supinator sign, where instead of when you do a brachioradialis reflex, there is absent brachioradialis, but there is contraction of the flexor, the exaggerated finger response, and it indicates a cord lesion at C5 or C6 level. The other two signs are the finger escape sign, where you ask the patient to steady the hand with the all the fingers in extension, and you realize that if the patient has a myelopathy, the little finger drifts away into abduction and then into flexion. So this is a finger escape sign. And the third is the grip and release test. Again, it is positive in cervical myelopathies, where you ask the patient to repeatedly do it. Normally a person can do it more than 20 times in 10 seconds, but if in cervical myelopathy, the patient takes a lot of time, and he tends to, and you will realize once you see it that it is a discomfort, and he may do the finger extension very slowly. So these are the two tests which are specifically done in cervical myelopathy. This is just again to concise. If you have a cervical spine, you will not have it. But cervical spine examination, thoracic and lumbar spine examination, if you just see these two slides before going for the examination, you will not make a big blunder, and you will do most of the tests in sequence. The working diagnosis always has to be a differential diagnosis in spine, because you cannot clinically diagnose anything completely by, it's not a spot diagnosis. This has to be there. You have to say that this is a diagnosis and I would like to investigate the patient. So most of the spine patients have to be investigated. So your diagnosis can be reached out from this clinical examination on history, but final viva will go basically depending on what examination, what investigations are put forward to you. Again, the upper limbs also, but primarily per se for each individual diagnosis, again we have three more talks to go where you will know specific examinations and diagnosis for that. Thank you.
Good afternoon, everybody. In the vertebral disc, the clinical diagnosis and approach to the management. Usually any long case, either hip or spine to be started, the chief complaints, then the history of the problem, that is the chief complaints, that is the onset, duration, progress, negative history about the particular problem, to rule out other causes of possible pathology. Then they will ask you for a provisional diagnosis on your history. So you need to know what exactly you are dealing with, and you can give a rough provisional diagnosis. Then comes the examination, and after complete thorough examination, especially in spine, then you can actually give the proper final diagnosis with definitely, as Dr. Pai said, the differentials need to be mentioned in spine. So we will just go through the chief, a major complaint a patient walks in into your clinic with a prolapsed disc is a low back pain, acute onset, or a low backache or a catch, radiating pain along with tingling, numbness or any crampiness to the lower limb, either right, left or both, inability to sit, stand, walk, with majority of the activities of daily living hampered, with leg pain and or back pain associated. Sometimes patient only present with leg pain may not have that much back pain or any aching pain. Then the particular pattern of pain radiation, which actually tells you which level is involved or which nerve root is getting compressed. weakness in the leg associated with pain, which again tells you what may be the approximate level of the pathology. Bladder and bowel complaints and pain affecting the activities of daily living. So on all these complaints, you need to become build up a history of how it started, the onset of any backache or a radicular symptom, whether there is any associated history of injury, fall, elevated pain, chronic cough, heavy sneezing, any associated other pathologies like tumors, infections, history of coughs or anything. Then the aggravating factors, again very important. The pain will aggravate on bending, stooping, lifting any weight, coughing, sneezing, as I mentioned. Relieving factors will be when patient lies flat supine with knee and hip in slight flexion, a pillow below the knee joint to relieve the tension of the sciatic nerve root. The negative history is very non-specific, in particularly for the prolapse risk. Usually you can just rule out, as you have to formally complete that portion of the history, any cox contact, any other major trauma associated, any other spondyloarthropathies, just to complete the list actually, because it is very specific and patient particularly draws the pain pattern in a proper sciatic pain distribution. So on this brief history or a detailed onset, duration, progression, plus associated chief complaints, you need to draw a provisional diagnosis, because a lot of examiners, mainly during the DNB exams, they ask what is your provisional diagnosis on history completion. So it is usually a lower limb radicular pain associated with paresthesia, that is tingling and numbness, possibly due to some compressive etiology in the lumbar spine. That should be just a provisional diagnosis. That gives the hint to the examiner that what he is dealing with. Many a time they have not seen the case particularly. Some examiner have seen, some has not seen. So you can give a hint that I am going to present and elaborate further this particular case. So examination, again this general systemic examination, you just have to bluff it in a single line along with the higher function, cranial nerves, everything. In one line you should finish it quickly. Don't waste your time on this, otherwise they will go in pallor, edema, sinuses, clubbing. So you have to be very crisp and quick. The local examination, wherein actually your fine examination starts, which is to be done in supine, sitting, standing and walking. So inspection, usually a patient with sciatic distribution pain or a radicular pain will have a typical gait pattern. He will have a slow, deliberate walk, holding on their loin like this and walk into your clinic with this kind of or a gait pattern, which is associated with either antalgic gait or maybe a Trendelenburg Burke gait if the hip abductor is weak. So that also in gross nerve root tension, the tiptoe walk, that means the patient doesn't put his foot complete plantigrade, he will try and walk on this. That means the nerve root tension is a bit released. Then any associated sciatic or the scoliotic list associated with this, you need to again complete formally the rest of the local examination, that is on inspection the head is well centered over the shoulder and the trunk and the pelvis. There are no any scars, sinuses, swellings or any abnormal patches or rash, which can be a herpetic rash along the lumbar radicle, which is a possibility, and any possible spinal deformities. So the just to highlight the sciatic list, which is very commonly asked question during your viva, the tilt to the opposite side is in the shoulder disc. Why? Because just above the shoulder of the disc, that this fragment is sitting. So to create space for and relieve the compression, patient tries to tilt on the opposite side. So there is some aggravation of the space or an increase in the space so that the leg symptom reduces. Exactly opposite to the shoulder disc is the axillary disc, which patient try to shift to the same side so that the axilla opens up and the nerve root goes away from the offending disc fragment so that the compression is relieved and the pain settles down. So this is very important. Usually it is shoulder disc presentation, so you need to know what is the sciatic list and where, which pattern of pathology will have what kind of the list. Then on palpation, you need to check for again formally temperature, tenderness, mainly tenderness for superficial, that is along the spinous process with your thumb. Then deep thrust tenderness with your thumb, which translates to middle and anterior column of the spine, so any pathology there you can rule out. And the rotatory tenderness again for the anterior column pathologies. Mainly it is utilized for any infective pathology like tuberculosis of the spine. Any swelling or paraspinal muscle spasms, palpable deformity or step, any pelvic obliquity or limb-limb discrepancy, you need to just keep a watch on that. Then to come after palpation, the spine range of movements. Usually in patient with acute disc prolapse and radicular symptoms, the forward flexion and extension is mainly restricted. More so the forward flexion, which has a pain. But if it is a big fragment sitting in, extension is more painful, and in, it actually increases the sciatic distribution pain. But the lateral flexion can be free and full to one side. It depends on the position of the prolapse fragment in relation to the nerve root. If the patient feels leg pain on extension, then it is indicated of a sequestered or a large extruded fragment. The neurological examination, again, Dr. Pai has in detail explained you, so I will not go into the details. The most common pathologies in the lumbar spine for prolapse disc is usually at L4, 5 and L5, S1. But the particular pain pattern, as I mentioned in the beginning, will tell you where which nerve root is actually getting affected. So you need to know at lumbar 3, 4 level what will be the pain pattern, which is along the back of the thigh, back gluteal region, posterolateral aspect of the thigh, and going on the front of the anterolateral aspect of the leg and the foot towards the great toe. Their typical numbness or decreased sensation is at around the anterior aspect of the knee and anterolateral aspect of the thigh. There is always a quadriceps weakness associated with this and maybe the atrophy, which you have to check for the girth. For L4-5, the pain pattern is again the posterior aspect of the back, gluteal region and posterolateral aspect of the thigh and posterolateral corner of the leg along with the dorsum of the foot. So that is specifically for the L5 root, which is the first web space of the toe. And the L5-S1 is again only on the posterior aspect, lateral aspect of the foot and dorsum of the foot. The special test, there is some mention made by Dr. Pai. The main test which is sensitive is the straight leg raising test, LASIK test, then well leg raise or cross SLR test, bowsting test, again a bit more specific test, and for higher lumbar pathologies, the femoral nerve stretch. So we'll just go through each test. So when patient has to be comfortable in supine flat on the couch, then the examiner lifts the holds the ankle of the patient, put another hand on the knee joint, front of the region, so that it doesn't flex, and gradually passively elevate the leg up to a certain limit. patient will not have any pain, but somewhere in the middle of the straight leg raise, patient start experiencing pain, which tells that there is a increased tension over the compressed nerve, and it is usually between the 35 to 75 degrees of the straight leg raise. The initial first 0 to 35 is usually the sciatic nerve or the nerve root is itself slack, so you cannot put tension at that. So if patient start, when you lift the leg and patient start wincing in pain, then it is definitely something else. There may be a hip pathology also, or patient is malingering. So first 0 to 35 to 40 degree is definitely not positive straight leg raise. Then a LASIK test, again at the level where you have a wincing pain at straight leg raise, just lower the foot by 5 to 10 degrees and passively dorsiflex the ankle, which will initiate and implicate the same pain which was there with the straight leg raise. This is more specific test for the nerve root tension. It is a bit less sensitive as we have seen in the previous talk. Then the cross leg SLR, which is a well leg raise test. Patient supine with the examiner lifts the normal leg, which is non-symptomatic, and after a certain degree of leg raise, there is a exaggeration or recurrence of the similar pain to the affected or symptomatic side of the leg. So that tells that the disc fragment is either in the central along with the posterolateral of the affected side. So a large central disc prolapse will have a well leg raise test positive. Ghosting test, again a specific test in which the SLR test will be done first, which increases the pain, then flex the knee by a few degrees and relieves the pain of the patient, and keep the foot on the shoulder of the examiner. So you just have to lean down and then put your pressure, both of your thumbs, be it in the popliteal fossa, and with your another finger, the lateral hamstrings need to be pressed, or in the middle of the medial to the lateral hamstring, which compresses the common peroneal nerve and increases the pain along the calf as well as the thigh in the typical nerve root. So that is a very specific sign for a nerve root tension sign. For higher lumbar disc prolapse, like at the level of L2-3 or L1-L2, which is affecting or compressing the L2 and L3 nerve root, the femoral nerve stretch test is very important. In this, the patient has to be on prone, flex the knee by 90 degrees and gradually extend the hip joint, which have a recurrence of the pain along the anterior aspect of the thigh. So another important, after this you need to have an associated examination, which is very important and which will give you a differential whether it is a disc or not. So most important, hip can give you a slip during the examination. All these nerve root tension signs are passive tests. So when you ask the patient to do an active straight leg raise, which is painful and restricted, definitely there is some either a hip pathology or sacroiliac joint pathology. So along with that, the hip range of movement will be painful and restricted. So that tells you that it's not a spine pathology, it's a hip problem. Same for the sacroiliac joint, the various tests as mentioned before, and peripheral pulsation, which will rule out the peripheral vascular disease. So how, after this detailed clinical examination, how you will put forth your diagnosis to the examiner? Anybody? No. So it is a particular limb. You can tell which nerve root or a dermatome or a myotome is affected, either L4, L5 or S1, radiculopathy due to compressive etiology, secondary to mostly prolapse intervertebral disc, of that particular level. If it is L5, you can say L4-5. If it is S1, you can say L5-S1, which is the most common presentation. It may be a variable slightly, depending on the level and the type of prolapse of the disc, with or without involvement of bowel and bladder, plus any functional disability in terms of any major activity restriction of the daily living. So this is what should be your diagnosis. So the definitely you can give differentials of all these trauma, infection, any other, as like I said, spondylodiscitis, osteomyelitis, any inflammatory pathologies, infective etiologies, neoplasms. So how will you manage a patient with rationality of the management? So first thing is you will like to do few investigations to confirm your diagnosis. So preliminary, first thing in orthopedics is X-ray. But X-ray for a prolapsed disc may not give you the edge to diagnose, because it is not specific. You cannot have a proper vision of the nerve root and all, because you can see only the bones. But yes, the amount of pathology on the bone will tell you the approximate level, as well as the possibility of any other interventions needed for the management. You can actually make some changes. MRI is more specific, which will actually give you the accurate and specific modality for diagnosis of the spinal pathology. It allows direct visualization of the herniated disc material along with its relationship to the dural structures. And it has definite advantage over myelography. Before the invention of MRI scan, there was CT myelography used to do. But again, it is far more better than CT myelo. There is no radiation involved in this, no contrast needed. And it is more accurate in all three planes, that is coronal, sagittal and axial. So just in brief, some theory, you must have gone through it, the type of prolapse: central, posterolateral, that is the paracentral, foraminal, that is far, like foraminal and extraforaminal, which is a far lateral, as depicted in this MRI axial films. Then the anatomic classification, the protrusion, prolapse, extrusion, and sequestration. So the treatment options on this. Majority of the prolapse intervertebral disc doesn't need surgery, except few indications. So the treatment modalities may be conservative, or a nerve root injection for relieving the pain, or a surgical method. So these are the possibilities. First, everyone will try to have a conservative management with bed rest for around 72 hours. There is no role of bed rest after 72 hours. Otherwise, the multifidus muscles start wasting very quickly. So you have to have optimized bed rest duration. Medications, again, standard muscle relaxant, non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drugs, and the steroids, and neuromodulators like pregabalin, gabapentin, and other drugs. Physical therapies like interferential therapies, short wear diathermy, the TENS, followed by exercises. Usually the flexion based or the extension based isometric exercises appear to have the better support in literature, offer benefit by decreasing the local muscle spasm and stabilizing the spine. And it can you can start it when the acute phase of the pain decreases. So there are newer concepts coming with the back school, that is the education of a proper posture, body mechanics to the young boys, helpful in returning the patient to the useful level of activity as quickly as possible, individual or the group instructions and all those things. Few lifestyle modifications which are essential. Then the pain management, as I said, the middle way of or a middle path regime for a prolapsed disc. The selective nerve root block, once you know the exact level of pathology, you can actually go in and under SIAM guidance, you can put a spinal root block, which is a mixture of steroid and local anesthetic. The surgical management. The surgical treatment is mainly for the absolute indication, sir, caudal equina syndrome or impending caudal equina syndrome with bladder or bowel involvement or a foot drop, deteriorating neurological deficit, grade 3 or more than loss of the power. The surgical options, this is last slide, mainly they won't go into the details of all this. They may just ask you what you will like to do is the surgical discectomy. There is concept of microlumbar discectomy, that is a targeted fragmentectomy. Then endoscopic discectomy, which has its own limitations. And minimally invasive spine surgical decompressions, which is right now into the market. Thank you.
Thank you. The next talk is about TP spine diagnosis and management by Dr. Namal Vijay.
So we'll try and make this. It's quite a big topic. So please try and answer when I ask you questions. So how many of you have seen or presented tuberculosis spine cases? Who has not seen TB spine case? All of you have seen that. And all of you know the theory very well? Yeah. Who does not know about TB spine? Good. So then I can just ask questions. I really don't need to do this lecture. So just tomorrow is Spine TB Day, TB Divas, Vishwa TB Divas, and India is going to have an aggressive approach. So hopefully after 10 years we won't have to give this lecture anymore. TB should get over by 2025. Yeah, and the third important message, I think that's absolutely right. That if you don't report TB, you will be in jail, not giving any exams. So, you have a long case for exams, TB spine, and besides that, in theory, you will get all these questions. Pathogenesis, clinical features, investigations, grading of spinal TB, early onset, late onset, paraplegia. So, there's a huge list. Management, anti-TB drugs, indication of surgery. So all these are DMD theory questions. So TB spine, I think everybody should know about it. So all of you know this, it is called Cox spine. So this is Dr. Cox who identified Mycobacterium tuberculosis, which is a gram-positive AFB. I am sure you all know this. This is the other gentleman who described these lesions, which are called?
Tubercle
granulomas. And he is Lennox. And this is what we call as Pott spine. This is Percival Pott, who also described Pott's fracture. So this is this three gentlemen you should know as far as the history of TB spine is concerned. The pathology. So where does TB come from? Yeah, anybody wants to answer? Can we have a mic? Yeah. So what is? How does the TB come into the vertebra? The answer now. Yeah. Shout.
So it can be from the parotidal plexus.
Yeah.
It can be direct from the gastrointestinal TB.
Okay. And?
Or it can be direct.
Direct infiltration is quite rare in the vertebra. Any other mode from which he said one is from the venous plexus. You know what is that venous plexus? Benson's venous plexus. Benson's valvous plexus. So the, if you have a genitourinary or a GI tract tuberculosis, the organisms can go. Second is from the lymph nodes and adjacent structure. And third common thing is? Hematogenous. So what happens? How is hematogenous happen? Where do you have the primary complex? From the lungs. And what is it called?
Bronchus
complex. Okay. So that is how hematogenous dissemination, that is the most commonest thing. Then you have the Benson's venous plexus and the paradiscal infection of 2 contiguous vertebra. This is the pathology. What happens is classically you have the paradiscal involvement. And that's why the disc, you know, the diffusion, the diffusion is by the diffusion from the adjacent structures. So you'll get involvement of the disc space, then there's formation of cold abscess and extravertebral involvement. Okay? So that is how the thing spreads. So the commonest area to be involved is dorsal tuberculosis, which is 42%, lumbar tuberculosis is 26%, dorsal lumbar is 12%, cervical is 12%. So this you should be aware that it is more common in the thoracic and thoracolumbar areas. Okay? So this is far as the distribution is concerned. So these are the different lesions. So one we discussed, the commonest lesion is the paradiscal lesion. The other is central tuberculosis. So what this can mimic? What you can get confused. Suppose you see an MRI which shows central body involvement, what will be the differential? Metastasis or tumor. Okay? So you should remember that. So that is very important. This is not very common, maybe 10 to 12%. Then you have the anterior tuberculosis, then the posterior element tuberculosis, and synovial, that is in the facet joints. So these are the various pathological areas which can affect the spine. So how to approach a case in exam? You get a long case, you first take a thorough history, general examination, remember inspection, palpation and movements, complete neurological charting, gait analysis if patient is ambulatory, determine the vertebral level and the cord level. You know how to count a vertebral level and cord level? Yes, anybody from the back row? Yeah?
At cervical level you add 1, in thoracic level you add 2 to the number of vertebrae.
Okay, roughly right, but you should know what is the neurological level and vertebral level. Where does the spinal cord end? L1. So examination of other joints and examination of abdomen. So important points in history, most of the patients would present with pain, stiffness, which may be referred to arms, intercostal neuralgia, epigastric pain, girdle pain. They will come with weakness, sensory symptoms, bladder bowel symptoms. As far as TB is concerned, two important things you definitely need to ask is night cries and evening rise of temperature. You know why there is night cries? The person's cousin goes off and then suddenly patient will get pain when he moves. Why there is evening rise of temperature in TB?
So the steroidal physiological release of the steroids in the evening, so that reduces the inflammation, that causes the fever.
So the level of it's going to be the level of the cortisol, okay, and the diurnal variation. Then you need to ask specifically about weight loss, anorexia, past medical history of tuberculosis. So there may be a past history. TB contact history is very important, okay, and the immune status of the patient, whether he has got, she is seropositive, whether he has got diabetes. So all these questions need to be asked in your history. Then you go to the examination. So what are the different stigmata of tuberculosis in general examination? That is very important when you present a case, long case, yeah. Different stigmata of tuberculosis in general examination. Okay. Case, anybody? No, this is stigmatized signs. You are examining the patient and you find certain things. Yeah, anybody? Yeah, lymphadenopathy, anything else? Thickened spermatic cord. Yes. Retentional conjunctivitis. So all these are signs. Lymphadenopathy, scar, sinuses, retentional conjunctivitis, thickened spermatic cord, and erythema nodosum. So in your general examination, if you have a TB spine case, look out for this. If it is not there, you mention that. That shows that you are already seen for that. Okay? Then comes the local examination. So in local examination, mark all the spinous processes, feel for superficial tenderness, deep tenderness, feel for spasm. Okay? Then this is specific to tuberculosis. These three words, knuckle, gibbous and typhus. So anybody knows the difference? Let's go on that side. What is a knuckle, what is a gibbous and what is a typhus? Yeah.
is involvement of one vertebra. Gibbous is 2 to 3 vertebra, and more than 3 vertebra.
Very good. So what is this new thing?
Gibbous.
Quadrant gibbous, yeah. Then you look for scars, sinuses, cold abscesses. Cold abscess can crack from from any side. Like cervical spine can go, even the upper limb from the lumbar spine can go in the lower limb. Suvas abscess is the most common. Look for a hip deformity. Then you check for lymphadenopathy, check for bed sores. The other examination Pai has already covered. So, but this is very specific to TB spine case. Then you do a neurological examination, do a motor examination, sensory reflexes, CNS examination, look for the gait. Okay, so what is this gait? Yeah? It's a spastic gait. Okay? Short stepping is very unlikely to get in neurological patients. So it's a spastic gait. Then classification of TB paraplegia. Anybody knows? Yes, Gautam? Classification of TB paraplegia?
Early onset or late onset paraplegia.
Very good.
Within 2 years and after 2 years, late onset paraplegia.
Very good.
Then
any other classification you know besides what about the severity?
Percentage unaware to the disease and percentage able to walk. And in stage 2, percentage aware but manages to walk. In N3, percentage unable to walk and in stage 4, bedridden.
Okay. So these are two different classification systems which you should be aware about. One is the depending on the severity. So on the severity, this is classified by Goel Cooley. So what he was saying, 4 grades, negligible, patient unaware of deficit, but on examination you can find a deficit. Grade 2 is mild, patient aware but can walk without support. Grade 3 is moderate, patient cannot walk. And grade 4 is severe, paraplegia with flexor spasms. The next thing what he was saying was the onset, early onset and late onset. So Hartik, early onset what is the causes and late onset what is the cause?
Early onset is within 2 years.
So what is the cause of early onset?
Edema, and then now root compression.
No, no. Root compression, cord compression is appearing due to what? But edema because of what? Pressure of the cold abscess, granulation, sequestra, okay, or the vascular problem. So that causes early onset. What about late onset?
Because of deformity.
Because of deformity. So if you get kyphosis, the TB heals, but the spine becomes kyphotic and you get late onset paraplegia, or there could be reactivation. Okay, late reactivation. So this is the causes of the late onset paraplegia. So this is what we covered. And this is the causes what we just said, early onset paraplegia before 2 years. These are the various things which you mentioned, abscess, debris, okay, and this is the late onset. So finally, in a case when you present, you would say that the final diagnosis would be something like this, or not a diagnosis, but the presentation would be something like this. Then this is a 65-year-old female, pain in thoracic region, 3 months duration, progressive, non-radiating, so you should go in depth about the pain, non-radiating, not related with rest, aggravated with activity, progressive weakness in, then come to the neurological, all the history, progressive weakness in both lower limbs, inability to walk without support, heaviness both lower limbs, increased frequency of urination, loss of bladder control lately. So all this needs to be going in a very systematic manner. Fever, then the systemic symptoms, fever on and off, anorexia, loss of 3 kg, diabetes, then the immunocompromised status, diabetic, no past significant medical history, husband treated for pulmonary TB 2 years back. So if you present in that way, it shows that you are thinking this of a TB spine case. General examination, pulse, BP, respiratory rate, so no stigmata of tuberculosis, you can specifically mention what we discussed before. Inspection, gibbous at lower thoracic spine, wasting of paraspinal pulses, palpation, superficial deep tenderness, D8 to D10, paraspinal spasm, gibbous which we saw before, okay, at lower dorsal levels, no possible soft tissue swelling or abscess. So this is how your presentation should go. Neurological examination, bilateral lower limb reflex power is grade 2. So, mention all about power, reflexes, plantar extensors. So what does this indicate? What sort of lesion, upper motor neuron or lower motor neuron?
Upper motor neuron.
Upper motor neuron. So sensations decrease below D12, gait could not be examined, upper limb examination is normal. So what is this? So what is the MRC bearing of this? Great?
4.
4. Okay? You should be able to do MRC reading of power, MRC reading of reflexes. Then finally you frame your diagnosis. 65-year-old female with 3 months duration, early onset paraplegia. Secondary, most probably due to tuberculosis of spine. Vertebral level, as I said, you to mention vertebral level and neurological level. Vertebral level D8, D9. Neurological level D12 with that involved. Okay? So any questions till now about how to present or any... So, suppose you have a TB case, then what do you do next? What are the investigations would you ask for? So you have presented your case, you have finished, examiner is very happy, things are doing well, then he is going to jump to investigation. So what investigations would you ask for in a TB spine case? Yeah. You want to answer?
X-ray.
Very good. Okay. So like this case we are presenting, what would you have? Just tell me. Everything you would ask for.
D8, D9 is the level.
Okay. Anything? Just X-rays. You are happy with just. So don't you know? Don't make me ask you a lot of questions. Just tell me everything you'll ask for. Anything else? Yeah.
Blood investigations. CBC, ESR, and CRP.
Very good. Anything else in blood investigation which you'll need while you treat the patient? Liver function test. Then to know his immune status, you'll ask for diabetes, HIV, anything else? Renal function test. Okay. So, the first set of investigations, as you rightly said, would be hemoglobin, ESR, CRP, LFT, RFT, diabetes, and HIV X-rays. And after that, you'll ask definitely for MRI. What is the role of Mantoux test? Do you think Mantoux test has a big role?
No.
Yeah? Why? Yeah, so it's not going to be very specific in our country, so not a big role. All these tests have been actually banned, so these are of no use. CT scan would be in selected patients, okay, where you are planning surgery. And bone scan and ultrasound may be of useful again in selected patients. So this is the list of investigations you need to be aware about. So X-rays, so somebody wants to read this X-rays, yeah? Late. MRI is more sensitive, so you need lighting regions to be more than 1.5 cm to be seen and 40% decalcification to occur. What you really see is osteopenia in the adjacent disc space, then you will see end-plate erosion, finally vertebral collapse, and you look for a soft tissue shadow. So if you see a shadow like this, what is it called? It's not seen in this X-ray, but what is it called? Birds? Bird's nest. Okay? So you should be aware about those terms. Then the MRI is the next. Whenever you MRI, you ask you to screen whole spine. Why?
Skip lesions.
You know what is the incidence? Around 7 to 10%. Okay. So here you can see there are 2 skip lesions. If you ask for the lumbar spine, you will miss that. So always screen the whole spine. What you see on the MRI, you will see marrow edema, end plate break, paravertebral soft tissue shadows, finally destruction, collapse and abscesses. So here you can see the epidural soft tissue pressing on the spinal cord and that is the abscess there. So there is a classification on MRI which you will be expected to know. It is given by Kumar. So this is on the radiological thing. So you can read this in textbooks. There are 5 stages. Pre-destructive, early destructive, mild angular kyphosis, moderate angular kyphosis and severe kyphosis. So I am not going into details. Finally, diagnosis. For diagnosis, you need a specimen. So nowadays, there is no role for empirical anti-cox treatment because there are a lot of atypical microbacteria, there are a lot of resistant microbacteria. You can get tumors which are mimicking as TB. So you should either get a sample either by CT-guided or by Siam-guided biopsy. So you get a biopsy sample and what do you send the sample for? Yes. Anybody else? What do you send a sample for? Okay, drug sensitivity. Anything else? And histopathology. First is histopathology. Second is the culture. So in culture, you ask for aerobic culture, ZN staining, LJ medium. This was the previous classical thing. Nowadays we do what is called as LGID culture and gene expert. What is gene expert? Very good. So you get the report same day actually. You can know whether the organism is resistant to rifampicin. So whenever you get a sample, always send it for this. So this, for histopathology you send in what? You send in? Formalin. For culture you send in? Saline. Good. So once you do that, the classical treatment is what you should know is middle path regimen. That is 4-drug therapy, rest and brace. And then you can change the drugs once you get the culture reports, which may take anywhere between 2 to 6 weeks. Then monitor the CBC, ASR, LFT, why uric acid, which drug causes pyrazinamide. And always have a baseline perimetry before starting AKT. Okay? Which drug causes ethermethyl. And X-ray. So you can monitor them. If clinical radiological improvement, you continue anti-tuberculosis drugs for 9 to 12 months. So this is the basic treatment for TB spike. So, you should know about these MRC trials, which have compared the ambulant treatment and radical surgery, and the outcome is same. This is just to show that the main treatment is medical treatment, not surgical treatment for TB spike. So, this is a case. This patient was advised surgery. We did a biopsy, it came as TB. And this, he got what the MRI done on his own, because he was very afraid that this is going to be a problem. He's a very educated guy, IT guy. And this is in 6 weeks after treatment. Okay? So you can see how medically patients can respond. So it's a medical disease. Remember that. So what are the drugs you should know? Weight-wise drugs. So tell us the dosage fast. Yeah? What five? Yeah. Then? Good. Then? Okay, ethambutol is 15, pyrazinamide is 25, okay? So you should know the drugs, you should know their side effects. This is very basic. As doctors, we are supposed to know this. Then there is something called as drug resistance. Primary, you know what are different types of resistance described? That is different. What is primary and secondary, you know? Yes, yeah?
Primary is direct contact with the resistant organism, and secondary is because of the inadequate treatment or...
Primary is a patient who has never received anti-TB drugs before. While secondary is patient has received the drugs and now gets resistance. This may be either because he's not taking the drugs properly or the drugs are not prescribed in a proper manner. He may not be calculating the weight and prescribing him the drugs. So that is secondary drug resistance. So you should be aware about this. You should be also aware about MDR and XDR. What is going to be commonly seen nowadays. So here it is resistance to at least one of the drug, major drugs, that is rifampicin and isoniazid. The two most important first-line anti-TB drugs. While XDR is resistant to these two drugs, as well as resistant to any of the fluoroquinolones, and at least to one of the injectable second-line drugs. Okay? So you should be aware about the definition of MDR and XDR. Next thing you should know, DOTS. You know what is DOTS? So what do?
Under supervision.
How frequently they take the tablets? So you have seen the DOTS box. Okay, this is how it looks. So day one they take 2 INH, then rifampicin. Day two nothing. And once they open that, there is a number written on that on which they have to say ring and tell. Okay, they will give a missed call. If they don't ring, then they get a phone call. Then you have to take this drug. So it's very effective. Okay, and it is free of charge. So this is, you should be aware about, because this is what our country survives on. What we see in these places is only, 5% of the population suffering from TB. But this is what is a major drug. Then you should know what is the indications for surgery. So this is a conservative treatment. So what, when would you operate a patient with TB? Yeah?
Response to TB for 4 weeks.
I would say more 6 to 12 weeks. So this is for non-responders.
Deteriorating neurology.
Very good. So under your supervision, the neurology is progressing. So the main line of treatment would be no response to conservative treatment, significant progressive neurological deficit to start with, late onset paraplegia which we saw before, and kids if kyphosis is corrected. So these are the main indications for surgical treatment. So you should know the principles. You may not know the surgery details, but basic principles is neurological decompression, debridement, that is the excision of the disease, deformity correction and prevention, reconstruction when required, and stabilization. So these are the principles on which your surgery is based. This is one, Dr. Bhojraj has given us the way to manage this, and he has classified them into four groups. So a patient who is fit, young, and it's mainly anterior disease, so you can do anterior surgery. A B group is patient who has got kyphosis, you do anterior and posterior. Here they have put subliminal wires. A patient who is not fit, you can do only posterior, but decompress from behind the anterior part. And for posterior spinal tuberculosis, you just do posterior. But nowadays, everything is done posteriorly. We either get bone-to-bone contact or you put a cage from behind. So this was, I think, about 83 probably, not 2001. So, but the concepts have now changed. So just to touch surgery briefly, so anterior surgery was the gold standard. Transthoracic approach or retroperitoneal approach, go and debride that, put in a cage, and that's how you do the anterior surgery. For cervical spine, again, you can do anterior surgery, so that is the bone graft there. Posterior surgery is now what is more of a gold standard, so you go two levels above, two levels below, debride, decompress the cord circumferentially, and stabilize. So the principle is what you will be expected to know. There are only two basic approaches, so neural decompression, stabilization, fusion, debridement, okay, and send all the material for histopathology and culture. Finally, last point is about the kids. Kids can develop severe problems. Okay, they can go into progressive kyphosis. So these are signs like risk which you should be aware about. So if you see on the X-ray, separation of facets, retroflexion of body, lateral translation on AP view, or toppling over, then there are chances that they will develop kyphosis. Professor Rajshekaran's paper is there which you can all go over if you are interested. How to calculate what is the expected kyphosis, and then if you get a child that is going to need anterior and posterior stabilization, okay, circumferential fusion. Any questions? Thank you. Yeah. So those grades you saw, four grades. So mild, moderate, severe, that's how you would classify for your presentation. So you know, mild and severe is very broad. You classify according using that classification.
Thank you, Amol, for the wonderful interactive tuberculosis of the spine. I think you will hear a better lecture on TB spine. Please remember all that he has said. And since it was clinical based interactive, we have decided to cancel the case presentation. Otherwise, we will be getting too late. So, Rajesh is going to talk equally on approach to a patient with scoliosis. Again, scoliosis is a long case. And in DNB, so they will 100% give because they love people. And in MS, maybe you won't get, but you should know how to deal with the patient of scoliosis, terminologies, and clarity of thought of what you should be doing. After which, we'll have a 5-minute tea break, carry your tea inside, and Madhav is going to do an interactive session again, last on X-rays, reading of X-rays, and spots. Right? Thank you.
You should be lucky to get a scoliosis case in your exam. First of all, a lot of sympathy from the examiners. First of all, it's going to be rare. Most importantly, the diagnosis is never in doubt. Okay, is there anybody over here who misses scoliosis in clinical examination? Right. So, what you need to understand is how to approach the case in terms of assessment and the basic understanding of the management. Even if you tell this much, I'm quite sure you'll be able to pass. Do not try to go too much into detail. I am sure quite a few of you, most of the institutes nowadays are exposed to scoliosis surgeries. But do not fall into the jargon what spine surgeons tend to use. Because the more you will talk, you will invite more and more patients. Right? So any one of you, can you tell me the X-ray diagnosis over here? Yes? Tell me. Anybody? I mean, I just ask you, is this something in doubt? Just tell me the extra diagnosis. Yes, but what about the scoliosis? That is MBBS diagnosis. Yes? Is it left sided? What tells you it's left and right? No, there is something written over there. Right? There is something over here. Alright, so this is left sided. What scoliosis? Region of the spine? This is dorsal lumbar area. What is dorsal lumbar part of the spine? From which segment to which segment? So is this, you look at the apex. What is the apex of a curve? The midpoint. This is the curve, the midpoint, maximally tilted, right? Or let's say this vertebra is the apex. So this is what? This is thoracolumbar? Thoracic. Right side is thoracic, correct? Is this the only curve that you see? So how do you know this is compensatory and this is not compensatory? So you understand? First and foremost, every scoliosis has how many curves on the X-rays? No. There are three. Look here. From here onwards, do you think this is perfectly normal?
No.
Understood? So, for the person to remain straight and he has a curve, there has to be something compensatory above and below. Without that, he will not stand straight. Right? So the body has a capacity to compensate. When that gets exhausted, still it will be visible. Are the shoulders at one level?
Yes.
The iliac crest is at one level. It is not at one level. Right? So if you have to really comment on this X-ray, there is a major curve, looks like more than 40 degrees, which is a right thoracic, compensatory left lumbar, also cervicothoracic. Understood? First thing you understand that every scoliosis has other curves as well. Correct? So let's go into little detail. What is scoliosis? Everybody knows about this. But is it just lateral curvature? What are the other components of deformation of a spine in scoliosis? Rotation and? There is also change in the sagittal curvature. It cannot remain the same. What are the normal sagittal curvatures? Thoracic kyphosis, lumbar lordosis, also cervical lordosis. Right? So, if you really want to describe a deformation of spine, you need to comment on all three. Coronal change is scoliosis. Sagittal change is ulcer, kyphosis, lordosis, hyperlordosis, hyperlordosis, hyperkyphosis, all those things. Plus, how much of rotation? And what is it that tells you about the rotation? When you look at a person, how do you know there is a lot of rotation? Correct. So, when you look at a person who has come with something, first it starts with the history, the complaints. And what is the commonest complaint of a person with scoliosis? Is not back pain, is not neurological, it is the observation of deformation. Usually it occurs when the shoulders or the wrist starts tilting, patient has apparently a discrepancy, or accidentally mother or somebody has seen also a screening program, which you don't have over here, but a deformity. Now, many a times, it is not the deformity of spine, but something else. Deformity of the rib, chest, or in girls, inequality of the breast, or something like that. So, actually the main problem is in the spine, but the other things get deformed as well, leading to trunk asymmetry. Now, there are cases where the patient may have back pain because of biomechanical fatigue. But whenever a scoliosis comes with a lot of back pain or a lot of radicular pain, what do you need to suspect? There could be some associated condition. Is there any condition which is extremely painful and give rise to scoliosis?
Posterior
disc. Hey man, you've been listening to the last few talks. Sciatic list. What is the commonest cause?
Disc.
A painful disc. So anything which causes pressure on the root, even if it is not disc. Can it give rise to scoliosis? It can. On examination and X-ray, we want to find out whether it is a structural curve or is it a compensatory curve. But anything is called a scoliosis. Understood? Osteodosteoma is a very good, but it is not that common. You remember what Sandeep told you? Rare things you should mention most rarely. So anything which causes pressure on the nerve can give rise to that also. Now, are there any other conditions which can lead to scoliosis? In pediatric age group, the commonest?
Neurofibromatosis.
Yes. So neuromuscular, paralytic, congenital deformations, right? So here also there are lots of things that you need to see on the X-ray to find out the etiology of the condition, right? Now the history can give you a clue as regards the presence of the reason or the type of scoliosis. What you need to ask is the consanguinity. Why do you ask for consanguinity? Anybody? Is there any other diagnosis, a short case that you ask for consanguinity? You have a pediatric deformity in the limbs. Do you ask for consanguinity history? Why? You like to go into family details. Pardon? Yes. So, there is something which is hereditary, something which is transmitted, could be autosomal link, but there could be something which is not at all known to be genetically transmitted, but it is familial. What is familial incidence without a hereditary gene? If you have it in the family, there are higher chances of developing it. For an example, hypertension, diabetes, rheumatoid. There is no gene which is localized or isolated so far, but you know if the sibling has it, there are higher chances that the other sister or brother will have it. Alright? So there are only few things what you need to understand. What is the other history you will ask? There are associated other anomalies. Why do you need to ask that? For an example, if somebody has calcaneus deformation, you ask for something regarding spine? Why? Syndromic condition, associated difficulties, neuromuscular problems. So all this will come as a group and it helps you to understand what it could be. Most importantly, you have to ask for progression. When was the first time it was found out? Is it progressive? How it was found out? Since the onset, has it increased the most important vital information for the treatment also? And if it is beforehand diagnosed, what is the treatment taken so far? When it comes to assessment, it is very obvious that the patient has deformation. But there is a systematic way you need to diagnose and present to the examiner. Now, scoliosis examination completely divided into examination of the spine as a musculoskeletal system, examination of the neurology, the CNS, radicular syndrome, everything. Then also the patient as a whole. So right from the patient's nutritional status, height, all these things will matter. Okay, so all three things do not forget. I will tell you the importance of general examination a little later on. So when you patient have an evaluation of the patient, all these things have to be noted and included in your presentation. Most important thing in the observation is you examine the patient behind, from behind, in all positions, standing, sitting, bending forward, walking, supine, prone, lateral also. What are the things you look for? Obviously the imbalance. The imbalance is noted by the shoulders, iliac crest, the curvature of the spine, the limb lengths, associated anomalies also you need to check. Right? So whenever you comment like this. Okay? The neckline, chest asymmetry, look at the scapula, look at the shoulders, look at the arms, look at the posterior iliac spines, right? And other things. Now, there are something specific. Always comment on Adam's forward bending test. This is the gold standard. Why? Why Adam's forward bending test? Anybody? Sometimes, you know, the child is chubby, you may not know. Second, the rib hump becomes more obvious when you bend forward. Okay? So when you look from behind, around 90 degrees forward bending, you see clearly inequality of the two halves of the chest. Right? This is what is clearly seen. Okay? Now, the other thing what you have to see is the flexibility of the curve, the lateral bending. That also tells you something very important. Now there is some instrument called as scoliometer. You can actually apply it in bending forward position and see, right? So all these things you try to measure. How much is the scoliosis, rib hump, whether it's getting corrected on bending, and you mention the associated conditions. Now also it might tell you whether there is any muscle spasm. You can see the muscles becoming very taut and forward bending sometimes is extremely painful. Mention that. There are very few conditions. What you see when you see the patient in the lateral profile or side profile? You mention all this, right? Here, the shoulder, the thoracic curvature, the neck curvature, lumbar spine, tightness of the hamstring, the patient, how she is walking, the pelvic obliquity from behind, but limb length measurements, all this have to be mentioned, lying down position, it could be supine, it could be prone. These things you have to see. So neurology, you make discrepancy, and in prone position, the spine is unloaded, then you see the difference when the patient was standing and difference when the patient is lying prone. It might get correct if the shoulder may become equal, right? So that is also very valuable information. And actually you try to hyperextend and see the push-prone position whether it is getting corrected. There are associated conditions. I will not go into detail of it. But when it is neuromuscular syndromic conditions, there could be something very, very specific. Like thrombus, dysplasia, hyperlaxity of the joints, and so many other things, and syndromic conditions like Marfan's and all that. Fortunately, this is not expected unless it's very obvious. And he may just mention that associated anomalies, patient could have a syndromic condition. Don't include here. Now, as a patient, as a whole, why do you need to examine? You have to see the sexual maturity. Why do you need to see this? Why? The potential for growth. Right? Potential for growth is indicated either from the skeleton through radiology or clinically the patient tells you. For an example, the history of puberty in a girl. You know that most of the girls, they're commonly having scoliosis compared to the boys. If they have already menarche, and they do not have, the importance is different. If the menarche has already not occurred, that means when it occurs, suddenly there is going to be growth spurt. So suddenly there is going to be increase in the scoliosis. Already the curve has reached a certain dimension. We expect the curve to grow a lot. So we will be vigilant. We will be watching it closely. And that is the patient who will require a more aggressive treatment. Understood? So try to mention manuscript. Okay, do not disrobe the patient and do all this if it is not comfortable, but mention in your examination that Tanner's grade or patient has achieved, menarche already. Now coming to the x-rays. Anybody, what are the x-rays that we usually advise for scoliosis? Don't read and tell me. Patient comes to you, let's say a 3-year-old child. Very mild scoliosis. What are the x-rays you'll advise?
Hanging x-ray.
3-year-old. I'm sure some of you cannot hang yourself on a bar just now if I ask you. 3-year-olds can't. Why am I asking that? If you start taking too many x-rays at 3 years, 3.5 years, 4 years, 4.5 years, every 6 months, he changes a doctor, he repeats. You know how much the radiological exposure? There has been a very good paper from UK which says 19% higher incidence of malignancy in some of these patients by the time they become adult. Okay? So stick to what you need. Usually a standing AP film is all that you need unless the scoliosis is already very high. Okay? Usually, if it is visible, diagnosis is not enough. You just need to measure. Second, if it is flexible, you don't have to take bending films also. Okay? Every 6 months also stick to the same. The only thing is, if you want to classify by the newer system by lengthy, then you need AP standing lateral of the whole spine. AP standing, bending, or fulcrum bending. Understood? So, 4 views minimum. Clear? On follow-up examination, examiner asks you, what will you do 6 months down the line? You will just repeat only AP standing whole spine. You will not keep on repeating everything. There is no role. Okay? Now the patient requires surgery, suppose. That is the time you are justified to repeat all 4 because it helps you to plan your surgery. Am I clear? The examiner asks you after your assessment, what are the investigations? I will do x-ray, this. Depending on the age of the patient, severity, whether follow-up or indicated or not, then the others. Other than x-rays, anything else you will do? Why MRI? Every patient of scoliosis is subject to MRI. When will you do? What is scanogram? What does it tell you in scoliosis?
The neurological deficit. MRI.
Let him say it. Scanogram, what is the role in scoliosis? There is no role. Okay? Lower limbs, do they have anything to tell you in scoliosis? No. Tell me, neurology, what are you talking about neurology?
Any spinal dysraphism associated.
Alright. So does the x-ray tell you or only
MRI?
MRI tell you. Does spinal dysraphism can be seen on x-ray as well?
Any twisted cord associated?
That's a different. Okay. If it is, let's say, something to do with the skeletal element, first of all, you'll assess. You'll see. the right answer to your question, I'll give you in a short while. Anything else that you want to talk about X-rays? There are a few things, right? Now, see, why do you take X-ray and study in detail? Because you want to mention from where to where. We talked about right-sided thoracic curve. In examination, you need to see whether it is from D2 or D3, whether ending at L1 or L2 or L3. So you need to understand certain things. You need to mention about rotation. You also need to mention about certain other parameters as well, right? So you need to study in detail. So how do you measure the scoliosis? Cobb's method. What is Cobb's angle? Angle between this and this. But what do you say? And what do you say? So the first question examiner is going to ask you, what is invertebra? Everybody is clear what is invertebra? You're not clear. This is something very distinct from any other case in orthopedics, that here you are expected to understand certain terminologies, right? So try to understand this. As I told you, there is a major curve, there is a compensatory curve, maybe a third curve. This end vertebra is the maximal tilted vertebra. The one which is superior is the superior end vertebra. Maximally tilted, not maximally away. Okay? So if you see from here, horizontal, slightly tilted, little more, little more, little more, maximum, again less, horizontal at apex, again inverse, converse direction, again, so it's inferior end vertebra, superior. Superior end plate of superior end vertebra, inferior end plate of inferior end vertebra, the smaller angle between them. Clear? Same way, this is also the end vertebra for this curve. So this same angle or from here and from here will denote the lower compensatory curves measurement. Clear so far? End vertebra, Cobb's angle. Stick to this. There are other methods of Ferguson and all, not expected from you. Okay? Now there are other things also. What are neutral vertebra? Anybody? This is the end vertebra, correct? This is the end vertebra. But what is this? Neutral. Or both pedicles equal. End plates parallel. Not tilted, not rotated, not involved in the curve at all. Neutral. When you go up, maximally tilted end vertebra. And what is stable vertebra? The plumb line will dissect it. This. Okay? These three are different. Clear so far? Now, whenever we want to measure, there's also something called as CSVL, central sacral vertical line. Because you measure this distance, how much away from the midline. So midline is not arbitrary. We have a midline of the sacrum. If C7, we draw a plumb line, that is central sacral vertical line. So we also measure the shift from the CSVL. We see the tilt, we see the Cobb's angle, and we also see the rotation. Now there are methods of rotation. Right? There is Nash and Moe, Cobb's method, and Mehta's RVAD. Okay? We should be proud of somebody. In Indian who has described this. This rib angle is basically the long axis of the rib, vertical, small. Now, what is the importance of this? Very low RVAD gives higher potential for progression of the curve as well. So, if you have a scoliosis in children, this is also a very important measurement, not just for rotation, but having the potential growth in future. Okay. So, just remember this. First, how do you see the equality of the pedicle shadows? This starts rotating. The maximal rotation you will have easiestly. This, okay? So, again, what is a tilt, what is a shift from midline, and the third is a rotation. This you can see on the X-rays only, okay? Now, the second thing what you have to see is not a coronal alignment, but a sagittal alignment. Normally, thoracic kyphosis, lumbar lordosis, most of the idiopathic scoliosis curves are lordo scoliosis. What you see clinically as a kyphosis is actually rib hump. So, okay, so what is the normal thoracic kyphosis? 40 degrees. Normal lumbar lordosis, 20 to 40 degrees. So they compensate each other. And there is a cervical lordosis also. Anything which goes above, hyper, less, lower, when thoracic kyphosis goes negative, it becomes a lordoscoliosis. Clear so far? So you need to mention about scoliotic curve, invertebrae, neutral vertebrae if required, rotational potential, clinically by rib hump, on X-ray, also the sagittal profile, right? Now something more that you have to see on the X-ray to judge the progression of the curve or potential is skeletal maturity. Now this, all of you know in orthopedics, what are the different ways of skeletal maturity, skeletal growth potential that you have to see? Hand X-ray, wrist, and Reiser's grading. I will not go into detail, I hope you know it. So when you say the history of menarche, secondary sexual characters, you also need to mention this to say that there is so much skeletal potential there. Now, why do you do the MRI? There's a clear-cut reason. Clinically, instead of a right curve, there's a left curve. It's very rigid. It's not flexible. It is extremely rigid. Lot of rotational alignment. There are some signs in the lower limbs, upper limbs, which may indicate some neurological involvement. Or it's a very rapidly progressive curve. Early onset scoliosis. Very young person, but very high curve. These are definite signs to indicate that MRI is required. But if you have an 11 degree curve at 6 years, not very progressive, looks like right thoracic idiopathic, you are justified not to do MRI. Alright? When you plan for surgery, you are justified to do MRI to remove any possibility of neurological complications by undergoing disorders. So 20 degrees is usually taken cut off at early onset and congenital also. Okay? Clear, understood, when will you do MRI? Examiner asks you, tell that these are the things, these are the reasons I will do an MRI for. When do you do CT scan? Skeletal abnormalities. What are those? Congenital, any vertebra, then block vertebrae, unsegmented bars, or you want to see a 3D picture of the whole scoliotic curve to plan your surgery, a pedicular assessment. You want to put pedicle screws. So there is a possibility there is a deformation of the pedicles, so you will do a CT scan. So coming to diagnosis to concretize, once you know that this is a type of scoliosis, you also need to have scientific language to communicate. So what are the different ways of to classify scoliosis? What is structural? More than 50 degrees, not flexible, even on bending films, not coming less than 25 degrees. That is a structural curve or a major curve. Alright? There could be one or more major curves or structural curves. Alright? Non-structural could be compensatory, like sciatic list, or a compensatory curve along with that left lumbar, which is becoming less than 20-25 on bending, is a non-structural curve. Okay? The etiology, it could be idiopathic, non-idiopathic. In non-idiopathic, it could be congenital, acquired. In acquired, it could be other things. Along with that, there could be neuromuscular. So, etiology tells you that this could be different reasons. What you may see is a paralytic scoliosis in CP or polio, or Marfan syndrome and others are not so uncommon as well. There are some reasons, very extremely uncommon. Now there are scoliosis secondary to surgery, iatrogenic, infection, or even fractures which are unequally that can also give rise to. Or heel cocks. Okay? Clear? So this is etiological. Now what we need to understand is, in idiopathic scoliosis, what are the classifications? Because you will be asked about this. So there are two major classification systems. One is King's, and the other one is Lenkes. What was the first instrumentation used for scoliosis surgery? Anybody? Harrington rods, right? So, all of you are aware what was Harrington rod? There was a hook on the top, hook below, and there was a rod to distract. So, when you use that system, you need to understand certain things about scoliosis. So, there was a system called King's classification, which to tell you whether it is appropriate to put Harrington or no, right? Then came the newer system, which are known as the segmental instrumentation system. So, King's classification or Harrington considered scoliosis as a unidimensional deformity, only a coronal curvature. So, you distract, it becomes stable. Then we understood that there is a sagittal also, rotation also. So, you need to derotate, you need to restore the sagittal alignment. So, then you have something called as Lenkes classification. Now, what is Lenkes classification? All these are subtypes. There are 1 to 6 types. There is 3 curves which I told you, proximal thoracic, main thoracic, thoracolumbar. So in type 1, the main curve is main thoracic, which is structural. Proximal is non-structural, this is non-structural. I'm just giving you one example, let's not go into detail of this. So what it tells you is more detailed way how the scoliosis can be interpreted. There could be 1 curve or 2 curves or 3 curves. It could be thoracic or thoracolumbar, which is a major curve, or 2 major curves. Okay? It also tells you what to correct and from what level to what level roughly gives you an idea. There is something extra called as lumbar modifier. You saw that CSVA. Suppose the lumbar curve is going beyond on one side or the other side, also tells you how far you have to go down when you push screws. So examination, what you need to say is Lenkes classification, more accepted, tells you in two dimensions, also tells us roughly the guidelines from where to where one has to include. For example, if there are two curves, will you include whole vertebral system right from D1 to S1, or will you stop somewhere to retain mobility? This is what you need to understand. Clear? Any doubt, any question about it? So these are the criteria for linking. How many curves? What level curves? Which structural, non-structural? Lumbar spine modifier, and there is something called as sagittal or thoracic sagittal modifier. It is normal kyphosis, lordosis, or hyperkyphosis. Okay? So if you have a scoliosis case, this is what you need to tell. This is what you already said, most of you, right? Sided thoracic. But what you have to mention is age, etiology, extent, exact measurement, which sided rotation, is there any other reason? The secondary thoracolumbar compensatory curve which was there, how many degrees that you have to mention, whether it is compensated scoliosis or uncompensated. With shoulder, both iliac crest, same level, compensated curve. When it is not, it is decompensated or uncompensated curve. Associated with any other problem which is underlying, what is the treatment, age of the patient, sex of the patient. If you tell this, you already passed, but do not go overboard to mention about this. Let the examiner ask you, you can say that these are the guidelines, I am not so sure. Any questions, understand so far? Okay, now there are certain prognostic factors, remember this, when somebody asks you, will you operate, is surgery required, what are the things you need to consider? Age of the patient, sex of the patient, growth potential, which is told to you by Rice's grading, and secondary sexual characters by Tynes grading. Type of curve, whether it is congenital, whatever, idiopathic. What is the curve measurement? 40 degrees to start with and 6-year-old is going to progress. Rigidity and progression, history if it is there. How much is the rotation and turn imbalance and associated problems, neurology or something. So these are the things you need to understand to judge whether what is required, right? Now, in idiopathic scoliosis, simple to understand. Up to 20 to 25 degrees, all you need to do is observe the patient. What do you mean by observe the patient? Call the patient every 6 monthly, repeat that AP X-ray, measure, compare the cross angle. If progression is more than 6 degrees in a year, usually it's a rapidly progressive curve, need surgery if it's going to go beyond certain level, right? But second group is 25 to 40. Okay, there is good growth potential, 25 to 40. What you'll advise the patient? Give that patient, usually the girl, corrective bracing. Most of the time in the day, even at night, 3-point correction, maximal usage. If there are already 40 degrees, good growth potential, advise surgery. Now there are certain things. If the curve is 30 degrees, but lot of imbalance already, lot of decompensation, lot of cosmetic problem, you need not do it. And it may be 42 or 45 degrees, but not at all visible, well compensated, you can wait. So these are not rigid guidelines, these are just simple guidelines to go by. Now, as I told you, it is dose dependent, have to use till skeletal maturity. There are various ways, but there is a definite evidence that some of the patients of borderline surgery may be prevented. When it comes to surgery, there are reasons why you do surgery, and the indications change from etiology, idiopathic to neuromuscular to congenital. But when it comes to surgery, there are certain things you need to follow. In idiopathic, more than 40 degrees progressive, skeletal immature patient, you need surgery. Whenever you operate, all primary or structural curves have to be fused. When it comes to secondary curves or secondary structural curves, you need to retain mobility also. Right? What is important over here is to understand where the curve is starting and ending. Like here, there are three curves. You need to understand which one is most important. It is the main thoracic. Here it is mild, not tilted, correctable, see the bending films, and you may not be required to correct it. You can see that this is the main curve. The other one is not. Okay? Now, choosing the fusion levels, I have told you, based on this. So, what are the goals when you come to surgery? Is it that you need to 100% correct every curve? Make a very rigid spine, looks very good radiologically, but which is not moving at all, completely immobile? No. What you need to restore is a trunk symmetry, stability of the curve, while doing this, maximally correct the curve, stop the progression by soundly fusing it, that means proper instrumentation, bone grafting, and also have radiological fusion. Restoration of the sagittal contour, proper kyphosis and lordosis. Doing that, maintain as much mobility below as possible, and do not jeopardize the respiratory function. That means if the chest is still to grow, child is very young, do not fuse it at that time. So this is how you plan. Identify invertebrae, neutral vertebrae, apex, flexibility of the curve, measurement of hip hump, kyphosis, lordosis associated, how much rotation, how fast progression. Right? These are just the, this is a very flexible curve, so completely corrected. Just you can have strategic placement, need not put implants everywhere. Right? So most of the idiopathic curves are treated by posterior only surgeries. Unless the curve is, you know, more than 100 degrees, very rigid, second or third surgery, we do not go anterior because anterior surgery has more chances of morbidity and mortality. Examiner asks you which surgery, as much as possible, it is going to be posterior. Posterior incision, posterior release, posterior decortication, posterior fixation and fusion. Right? Now, what are the instrumentation used? Most of you will see only the pedicle screws. From occiput to S1, we use screws everywhere. But there are implants like hooks or sublaminar wires, sometimes they are used. Okay? This is another case, relatively less mobile, and multiple Ponti's osteotomy better. Ponti's osteotomy is a technique where you make every vertebrae mobile, cutting off the lateral structure, the facets and everything. But the technique remains the same. Posterior incision, posterior fixation, posterior release and fusion. Now fusion should always, should be going to neutral, or you end at N vertebra plus 1. You make the vertebrae parallel. So where you stop, it has to be parallel. If you have curved steel, it will progress above and below. As much as possible, do not go below L3. If you go below, there is a degeneration of the adjacent disc. So just remember these simple things. That you include the primary structural curve, stop as much as possible at L3, do not go beyond, restore the surgical contours, correct curve as much as possible without causing any damage to the neural structures, intraoperatively there is a way. Just example, rigid curve. Now, if there is a more than 100 degrees curve, you do anterior surgery first, a release, multiple discectomy, maybe internal costoplasty, make it mobile, turn her over, and then do posterior fixation. Like in this case, the patient had caffeine spots. What could be the diagnosis? What are the other stigmata of...
axillary crackling.
Anything else? For diagnosis, you require how many? Okay. Then there are stigmata in the spine. Tensile thinning of the ribs, dural ectasia, osteopenia, osteoporosis. These are type 1, type 2 curves in neurofibromatosis. So these curves require anterior fusion as well. You cannot rely just on posterior implants. So this is an indication for an anterior surgery, which is becoming rarer and rarer. We do it only in certain cases. Now, this was all about scoliosis in idiopathic cases or that neurofibromatosis. When it comes to congenital, the criteria are different. You may operate very early. If it is rapidly progressing, you know it's a hemivertebral incarcerated with opposite bar. You need to do as early as possible. There are surgeries like hemiafacialdiasis, hemivertebral excision, and growth rods. Let's see a few. All of you should remember this. It's basic classification. So this is an example. There's hemivertebra. This will keep on growing, go other way. This child was very young, I think 3 or 4 years, but we still had to do surgery, excise it completely, she's doing fine. So in congenital scoliosis, the criteria are different. You need to see frontal and sagittal balance. So if there is normal, you do posterior only. If there is imbalance, you need to do only posterior, but if it is correctable. If it is not correctable, you may require a resection of the vertebra and osteotomy in the instrumentation. If it is associated kyphosis, you need to correct that also, either with inuterine excision or partial correction. And lordosis, if it is there, only anterior. Posterior surgery is contraindicated. So these are definitely different criteria. You need not remember everything. What you remember is, in congenital, rapidly progressive, if there is early presentation, do not wait for the child to grow, offer surgery. Okay? This was the patient corrected, came late, so complete excision, complete correction. Another hemivertebra, complete tilt, inequality of the crest, hemivertebra excision, complete correction. So there are other procedures for rib hump, for rigid scoliosis, adult presentation, recurrence. So VCR is the most aggressive, when you take it out at the apex 1 or 2 vertebrae. So you have made spine mobile, and then you fix and fuse. early onset scoliosis is the last thing that I'm going to tell you. What happens if the patient presents very early? He's 5 or 6 years, already he's 40 degrees. Will you offer him correction and fusion? What will happen if you fuse at that? What do you mean by growth? Limbs are still going to grow. What happens is 1 mm increase in the height of the thoracic spine results in 1 cubic mm increased space for the chest. What is the risk? You have a child where you have fused the thoracic spine, limbs are going to grow, body requirement of the cardiovascular sufficiency is going to increase, the chest capacity remains limited, you're creating cardiovascular insufficiency. There's a direct bearing on the patient's life expectancy, right? So there are various problems for this. There's crankshaft, implant mold is not good, bones are cartilaginous, lot of morbidity because structures are small, the nerves are small. So what you need in this case, this is something we had done very ugly stage, long time back, not very happy about the result. This was anterior surgery, still saved some segments, did well. But now, if anybody comes with a rapidly growing, ugly onset scoliosis, what you have to offer is something called as growth rod. What do you do when you want to, let's say a child which requires fixation for a bone and you want to do limb lengthening? Either you do Lizarrow or lengthening with the rods inside, correct? Apply the same principle for spine. So there are rods where every 6 months or 8 months you distract a bit. Or you can do it without opening, called as magic rods, they are magnetic. So just with magnetic pulse, it opens up 1 or 2 mm. Okay? So the principle is, now this guy was just 4 years old, already severe, you can't wait, they're already around 80 degrees. So you just minimal invasive surgery, you just open distally, proximally, you put these screws here, here, connecting nominos, and these are subsequent. This is at 8 months, maybe 1.5 years, now 3 or 4 distractions. Already it is partially corrected, the guy has grown by almost 5 to 6 inches. We will continue this as much as possible till it is closer to 30-40 days. There will be a problem, there will be rod breakages, implant cut out, all this. Possibly we need to change the rods. Important is, he is going to be having good vital capacity, good chest capacity by the time he achieves skeletal maturity. So this is about to conclude that in scoliosis surgery, what we use nowadays is all pedicle screw system. Sagittal alignment is equally necessary. I already told you about different kinds of curves. When you actually do the surgery, you can correct the curve by extraction, compression, derotation, something called as vertebral column dissection, or there could be cantilever reduction, etc. All these things have excellent results. Only 2% should have arthrosis. Most of the long segments they do very well. These are all the parameters that you should follow when you treat scoliosis. Early detection, proper assessment, good follow-up, be vigilant about indication. Treatment as per the guidelines, what I have told you, the type of this thing. Whenever you fuse, stop at L3 or above. Non-idiopathic, whenever possible, go in early. Cognitive curves, even at earlier age, you go and fuse. Just remember this algorithm. Up to 20 degrees, observe. 20 to 40 degrees, bracing. No progression, that's all is required. Progressive, then go for surgery. If more than 40 degrees before skeletal maturity, rapidly progressive, cosmetically uncompensated, then most probably posterior surgery fixation. Thank you so much for patiently. Excited at a time, but if any questions.
Thank you, Dr. Rajesh. We will have a tea break for about 5 minutes. I request all the students to come back with their tea. We are starting the last talk in just 5 minutes. Thank you.